in the Political Economy of Race and Gender. She is the author of The War on Welfare, Family, Poverty, and Politics in Modern America, co-author of Welfare in the United States, which is a document reader, and the author of numerous articles about the welfare state, feminist activism, and class politics in the late 20th century.
Thanks to Professor Ritzheimer for putting this together, and Bob Techno, and to the Bob Cultural Center for hosting us. This Time magazine cover makes an explicit comparison between today and 1968, when African-American communities in Baltimore and many other cities exploded in response to the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. It got me wondering how comparing these two moments might help us better understand where we find ourselves today. I first noticed a number of similarities in official and public discussion of these events. On the one hand, we see a broad condemnation of the so-called rioters and the violence, meaning property destruction, that they committed, even from the liberal end of the political spectrum, including a kind of required ritualistic scolding from African-American public officials like Baltimore Mayor Stephanie Rawlings Blake, who called them thugs, and President Barack Obama referring to criminals and thugs. Yet alongside this, and often from the same voices, we see an acknowledgement of the social, economic, and political conditions that fostered the frustration and the anger that erupted in the wake of Freddie Gray's death at the hands of the city's police force. And throughout this debate today, as well as in the late 1960s, we see what I think is a dangerous conflation of those two points of analysis in claims that the so-called rioters are the victims and or the perpetrators of what in the 1960s would be called a culture of poverty, what in the 1970s and 80s might be called a pathological underclass, and what in the 90s might be called a welfare culture, or simply gangsters, criminals, and thugs, although perhaps, just perhaps, made such by circumstances beyond their control. And a great example is David Brooks's column May 1st in the New York Times. He begins the column casually, both exaggerating and minimizing the pain that communities are experiencing by writing, "Lately it seems as though every few months there's another urban riot."
Jesus.
He goes on to assert the supposed failure and futility of government anti-poverty programs, and I'm quoting him here, "Saying we should just spend more doesn't really cut it. What's needed is a phase shift in how we think about poverty. Renewal efforts in Sandtown and Winchester prioritize bricks and mortar. But the real barriers to mobility are matters of social psychology, the quality of relationships in a home and a neighborhood that either encourage or discourage responsibility, future-oriented thinking, and practical ambition." Now, to be fair about our current debate, Brooks has been soundly flogged, both in print and the blogosphere, but much of the debate centers on the direction of cause and effect. So Brooks echoes what was, in the late 1960s, an increasingly mainstream political response to racial inequality by claiming that ghetto culture, as they saw it, produced poverty. Paul Krugman's rejoinder to Brooks and many other rejoinders reflect the Liberal Party line of the late 1960s by inverting that equation. It is racism and poverty that produce ghetto culture. Either way, the supposedly perverse culture of urban African Americans in these rhetorics becomes the explanation for the so-called riot. Both claims oddly skim past the actual voices of Baltimore's protesters and the protesters of previous decades. And despite such similarities in the debate in the 1960s and today, what seems strikingly different, I think, in today's discussions is the role of race and racial inequality in the conversation. In 1968, a massive civil rights movement had spent at least a decade highlighting the pervasiveness of racism and the brutality of racial inequality throughout the nation. While many officials dismissed the several summers of urban rebellions as the work of communist agitators, the nation could not ignore the fundamental role of racial inequality, structural institutional racism, in producing the frustration behind the uprisings. The four summers before 1968 saw hundreds of riots or urban rebellions, depending on one's political perspective, In February 1968, 2 months before Baltimore and dozens of other cities exploded in the aftermath of King's assassination, the Kerner Commission, appointed by President Johnson to investigate the causes of civic unrest, released its findings, which included the following frank points about race in 1960s America. First, the riots were almost invariably sparked by confrontation between local police and African-American community members. Second, residents justifiably perceived the largely white police forces in their neighborhoods as an occupying force, there to protect the interests of privileged white communities rather than the interests of black community residents. And third, the underlying conditions of racial segregation, high unemployment, lack of city services, inferior schools, et cetera, provided crucial context for the frustration in these communities. In other words, the Kerner Commission ultimately understood the uprisings as a political response to unjust circumstances, rooted in the racist structures built both physically and politically by public policies as well as private practice. Historians have since taught us much more about those processes of racialized post-war development that shaped the fate of Baltimore's black population and that of the nation's other cities. We know, for example, how public policy subsidized racially exclusive suburban development, which drew jobs and tax revenue out of cities. Baltimore's African-American population grew in the post-war era as its white population shrank, and as its blue-collar economy, once rooted in docks, garment shops, and steel mills, crumbled. The city lost over 100,000 manufacturing jobs between 1950 and the end of the century. We also know now that mechanisms of urban renewal, highway construction, and slum clearance equated mixed race and black neighborhoods with blighted neighborhoods and led to further urban disinvestment. Consider the attitude of famous city planner New York's Robert Moses speaking about one Baltimore project. "Nothing which we propose to remove will constitute any loss to Baltimore," he said, "of the 200 blocks of shops, hotels, taverns, schools, and churches. The more of them that are wiped out," he said, "the healthier Baltimore will be in the long run." We do see an occasional inversion of memory when we talk about the 1968 Baltimore riot. Some Baltimore residents and public observers assert that the four-day uprising of 1968 was in fact a cause of Baltimore's economic and racial crisis. But it's clear, and was recognized clearly by many public officials at the time, that the uprising, coming after 15 years of sustained protest, community organizing, and anti-racist and anti-poverty activism, was in fact the result of such a crisis. The long history here is a crucial context for today, but so too are the intervening years. It would be too easy to just leave it there. We're 50 years on now. Two crucial changes since 1968, I think, make recent events in Baltimore and other cities particularly confusing to many Americans, particularly white Americans. First, white Americans' professed attitudes about race and racism have changed profoundly. Many more African Americans have had opportunities unheard of before the Civil Rights Revolution. This, I would argue, is why Americans are having a harder time than in 1968, in some senses, accounting for recently publicized incidents of police brutality and community protest. Baltimore has been particularly puzzling as African Americans now hold numerous official positions. The mayor is black, 40% of the police force is black. This is confusing to many white Americans. Second, the engine of racialized capitalism and urban development that I described for the post-war era has continued apace in similar forms, yet in a new post-industrial context. So even as African Americans won positions in city government, Baltimore was named in 1990 as one of the nation's 16 hyper-segregated metropolitan areas. Consider the following. In the context of the broad rise of economic inequality nationally since the 1970s, Baltimore's racial gap in employment has grown steadily since the 1970s. In the 2000s, black income in the city declined faster than white income. In an update of urban renewal, planners rested the city's late 20th century urban renaissance on large-scale development, an aquarium, a baseball stadium, the Inner Harbor, designed to attract young, white professionals back to downtown. And as part of that effort, Democratic Mayor Martin O'Malley in the 1990s jumped on the national tough on crime bandwagon. As Sonia Kuman of the ACLU calls it, a dragnet style of policing, along with the militarized urban police forces that developed in the wake of federal war on drug policies, resulted in a national crisis of mass incarceration, and more particularly, the hyper-incarceration of African-American men. According to one study, in 2005, more than half of Baltimore's black men in their 20s were either in prison or on parole. Freddie Gray's neighborhood had the highest incarceration rate in the state. And finally, not finally, but finally for the time I have, a new wave of disinvestment in the 2000s as predatory lending policies targeted working class minority communities. A former loan officer with Wells Fargo testified in 2012 that she and fellow loan officers targeted majority black communities. They called their clients mud people. They called their subprime mortgages ghetto loans. Baltimore had the ninth highest number of foreclosures in the nation last year.
These were just some, I'm going to skip past them for time, but these are some pictures of 68. And then here's just some economic stats on Sandtown, Winchester, and Baltimore.
So despite the racial dimensions of neoliberal capitalist advancement in the United States, it seems harder today, I think, when Americans celebrate multiculturalism than it was in 1968. To see clearly the complex spatial, structural, and institutional mechanisms of racial disadvantage, especially in a city like Baltimore. As historian and columnist Nathan Connelly wrote, quote, in the absence of a perceptible white power structure, the discussion around Baltimore has quickly turned to one about the failings of black culture. The explanation for the 1960s riots that might have the most relevance today, but the one that is largely absent from the discussion, is in fact, I think, the black power analysis. Stokely Carmichael and Charles Hamilton offered a colonial metaphor for understanding the complex interactions of political economy and social and cultural domination that maintained racial inequalities and urban poverty, all the while remaining largely invisible.